Hey again, Jamie from Celebrity Wine Review on loan. I've been chatting to Hilton and Wendy, two people who make some pretty amazing wines that we've been trying today with lunch. This is the Chenin Blanc, and Hilton's going to tell us a bit about it, because he could do it much better than I could.
I'm married, I can only tell you a little about it. My wife will tell you everything about it. Wendy is the expert I've discovered in everything. De Morganzon is the most extraordinary estate. I say this despite the fact that Italy is quite a pretty place. France isn't too bad, but Stellenbosch is the best terroir in the world. Right, James?
That's what the guy at the wine fair in London told me, yeah. Stellenbosch is the best terroir in the world, but he didn't actually say why. So, come on, you need to elaborate. Why is it the best terroir in the world in Stellenbosch?
Well, when Bordeaux was still a swamp being drained by the Flemings...
Dutch engineers.
By Dutch engineers. We were making wine. I mean, 360 years is a reasonable pedigree. I personally wasn't 360 years ago, though Wendy sometimes starts that. Why do we have the greatest terroir? We have extraordinary mountains. We have the oldest soils in the world. We have paradise. And how can you grow anything in paradise that's not ambrosia? Darling, do you want to tell
Wendy,
the wine?
could you beat that?
I could not beat that. Absolutely not. But what I must say about De Morganzon particularly is that it's an extraordinarily beautiful farm. And it's mountain vineyards. It's very difficult to farm because of it goes up 250 meters with these absolutely extraordinary mountains to the sea. So we get the cold evening breezes.
Oh, perfect for those acidity and the white grapes.
Absolutely. So this is one of the most pristine sites in Stellenbosch.
Well, I mean, I love the wine, but you know, a lot of people in Stellenbosch make Chenin Blanc oak and oaked. I mean, if you were up against a jury, what makes your wine particularly unique or special? Why?
These are 40-year-old vineyards, which give us a very, very low yield. So we get under 3 tons a hectare. So it's particularly special. We don't drop bunches of grapes because we basically can't afford to drop bunches of grapes. So we very select in the vineyard where we cut off anything that is not going to come into the bottle and make something this stunning. So we will go through and we will cut off green grapes, we will cut off anything that isn't absolutely perfect. And we only use the free run juice. So this is a very expensive wine to produce. It then goes into French oak for 9 months, 40% of new oak and 60% second fill. So it is, we threw bells and whistles at it, but I have to say that we were amazingly rewarded by the fact that our maiden vintage got 5 stars, and in the 90s, in Robert Parker and Jancis Robinson, everybody raved about it. And it became a real stick to beat ourselves up with.
always improving, always getting better.
Absolutely.
No, it is. I think the Loire Valley sort of, you know, winemakers would be a little bit jealous because it's absolutely superb. But where can you get hold of it? Where are you guys selling into? Who are your main markets?
Cape Classics distributes for us across the United States. We don't make a huge quantity of it. We make very little, in fact. So it's available in specialized wine stores, in some of the very best restaurants. Fantastic seeing on the wine list at Danielle in New York, where if one could afford it, one would drink as much as one could have. I think it answers your earlier question more seriously, James. I think the structure speaks for itself. I think the acidity.
It's magnificently balanced.
I agree. It's a beautifully balanced wine, and it will age as well. There's some fat from the oak, and you've added a lovely extra layer, obviously, of structure and dimension, but it doesn't kill the fruit. I mean, some of the oak Chenins I've had from Stellenbosch and French oak, they're too oaky. So I guess it's a difficult balance for you guys to make sure that the fruit's still there and you're not assaulting the wine with the oak. And I think you pull it off very well. But, you know, you were talking earlier about the music and the vines responding well. What's all that about? Because when you first said that, I thought, psychiatric job. But seriously, I mean, what kind of music, how does playing music to vines produce better quality fruit? Tell us about that.
Okay, people think when we speak of playing music that we are entertaining the vines in some peculiar way, or with their little sort of leafy ears, they're listening to what we're playing to them, that they're sort of preferring Kirito Kanawa to John Sutherland. They're not. They're responding to the wave, and it's purely the wave. And everybody says to me, well, what's waves make no difference? Well, go to the kitchen and look at this little thing that'll heat up the food and put your hand into it. And that is... that's waves. But seriously, we play Baroque music. We have huge speakers in the vineyards. We play 7 days a week, 24 hours a day. And the music that we use is, as I said, it's all Baroque. It ranges from Albinoni to Zelenka, a little known Czech composer, I think is sadly little known. Quite a lot of Vivaldi, unfortunately.
Not the full season, I hope.
Sadly, the vines have got to tolerate it. We have included in our Baroque Haydn and Mozart, despite the fact they're not technically Baroque, but it does add so much more. I mean, how much of a blinking harpsichord can you listen to?
So what's wrong with Beyoncé? Why don't you experiment with the Beyoncé, you know? No? You don't think they'd respond well?
I don't know. I would hate to risk it, A, and B, we have neighbours, and I would hate to risk them, because would you like to listen to Beyoncé all night?
Well, no, but I'm not a vine. Okay, guys, well, look, thanks for sharing the wine with us. It really is superb. And I'd like to toast you guys.
And oh, thank you.
To wine and music.
Thanks.
Cheers. Cheers, guys.